going on, ladies and gentlemen? It's the Justmisslee Experience. Welcome to another show where it's going to be a experience.
Biggest topic, any topic, we prepared, we ain't scared, we just we be talking sex, lies, yeah, whatever. My homie JT, D&B Sports Center. Yeah. Miss Lee bringing guests after guests after guests. And we gonna
competition.
We demand our respect. Check out the check, yeah, we eat. This ain't a podcast, this is the life that we lead. From relationships, politics, you hear it all here. Got stilettos and combos and fashion right here. If you wanna throw the lead, hit a rut right quick. Or you can download on iTunes, you know she that. Got the show on YouTube, and no, man, I swear she the shit. My homie T-Wave with up, no, we up in this bitch. Feeling champagne, celebrating this year. The next year, at the next year, at the next year, at the next year, at the next year. For the Justmisslee Experience. Oh. Welcome.
About power. We're talking about who got the power over your life, who drives you, what motivates you. You know, how do you lose control and regain control, and how do you help your babies understand power and all of that. So that is tonight's topic. And we have a very special guest that's going to be joining us tonight on the show. He is the New York Times bestselling author. He wrote, Milk in My Coffee, to Cheaters, to Finding Gideon, so many wonderful books. Jerome Dickey is going to be joining us as well. But before we get into the bolts and nuts and the bolts and the milk and the cookies and the meat and the potatoes, I got to say what's up to my boy T. What it do? How you living?
What's good, Lee? What's good, good people? All y'all out there in radio land? We out here doing it. It's another Friday. Back at you.
Yeah.
We're coming at you live and direct. Live and direct. So, you know, it's been a crazy week. You know, it's been a crazy week. You know, all over in all kinds of ways. But I'm glad that, you know, we're getting into this topic because I think it could be a fruitful conversation. So, you know.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead and jump into it.
I think so too. We're talking about power, and you know, I definitely want to hear your feedback and your comments and your thoughts and your feelings and your concerns. So, you know, of course, phone lines are open. 347-934-0949. We got Instagram, it's Justmisslee. Twitter, Justmisslee. And Facebook, the Justmisslee page. You know, so we want to hear you and get engaged with the show. You know, because there's so many. You know, like you said, T, like there's so many layers to this word power, you know, and I think everybody, like through your life experiences, you run to a situation where you're in control or you lose control, you have to share your control, or, you know, there's a dominant and a not so dominant individual that's engaged in a situation or a task or a relationship or something, and it's like, how do we deal with someone who has power not only over, you know, your life, but also how do you understand that you have power too? Like, it's so loaded. It's such a huge word. T, have you ever been in a situation where you, like, felt like you didn't have power over your life?
I don't know if I say power over my life. I mean, I okay. can't say that I've been in a situation where, as I sit here and think about it, like, some of the situations that I've been in, like, where it's, like, I don't have no control based on, you know, what's going on and the situations around me and the stuff that's popping off. Like, yeah, like, I've been in situations where it's like, you know, whether I lived or died wasn't up to me. It was, at the end of the day, it was totally, totally up to God, the man above, that got me through the situation. But, you know, like, on a day-to-day basis, like, as far as work or stuff like that, or, you know, no, it's not too much where, you know, long-term, not necessarily situational, long-term, that I don't feel like I have power. You know what I'm saying? It's like, other than them situations where somebody's pulling guns, and it's like, whoa. You know what I mean? I felt in full control. But in those situations where, you know what I'm saying, where bullets is flying and stuff like that, then at that point, you know, life kind of flashes before you. You know, when you in a car accident, you know what I'm saying, and that car is spinning out of control, you know, life is flashing by you. So, like, at that point, all you can do is recognize the power of the divine. Because it's like, whether you live or die, that's up to God. So, you know what I mean? Right. At the end of the day, for me, ultimately, God has power over my life. Like, that's the only entity that I yield power to is God.
Right.
Other than that, I keep it moving. Like, I don't feel nobody else. Like especially with the job. Like, I don't never feel like, oh, they got power over my life and they can make things. Nah, it's a job. And if you decide tomorrow, if my employer decides tomorrow, you no longer have a job here, okay, I keep it pushing. That's not the end of me. But a lot of people don't see it like that. And it's like, oh, my God, I gotta have this job. I don't have my job. Yeah. I'm going to jump out the window.
Right.
I mean,
I was going to say, like, a lot of people do feel that way, and they feel that way because you're not walking in your destiny. You're not you haven't uncovered what you're supposed to do. So you've made that job, and this is some people, you made that job your end all be all, or you've devoted so many so much time, energy, sacrifices into that employer that you lost your own walk with what you want to do. But I know a lot of people that feel like their job controls all of them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I mean,
you know,
like, that,
living to make that paycheck.
It's like, what am I going to do? I can't afford to lose my job. Yes, you can.
Because
if you lose your job, you know what? You're going to be all right. But there's people that yield power of their employer. Mm-hmm. So when things are going wrong in their workplace, they're not willing to step up and be like, this ain't right. Like, I've worked for shitty employers. I've worked for people that were like, you know, they treated their people with disrespect. They didn't treat them with kindness and humanity. And they treated their people like shit. And, like, I was like, you can try that shit with me if you want to, but let's get this one thing straight. I don't give a fuck about this job at the end of the day, because I can always go get a new job. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So what you think, what you thinking that you want to take advantage of me, you might want to think twice and then think like 100 more times after that, because that ain't popping off. So, you know, and I think that's the thing, because like I tell a lot of young folks that, you know, that I end up working with, like, you know, they fresh out of college and everything. That's their first job. They happy. Look, it's a job. That's it. You need to come into this thinking that you work for yourself at all times, regardless of who your employer is. You work for you first and foremost, and what's in your best interest should be your first interest. Now, what's in the best interest of the company? What's in your best interest? And when I start hearing companies be like, oh, we're a family and we're a unit and we need to come together and assimilate for the good of the company, that's when my antennas go up. And I be like, what kind of bullshit y'all trying to get over on these people?
Yeah, it's just the employment power, I think, most of Americans struggle with. You know what I'm saying? Because it's like you have to sacrifice. Some people feel like you have to sacrifice your happiness to get the paycheck because you can't see the means to an end. So some people do feel powerless because of the politics and the people and the stuff that's going around. And I think to a degree, everybody ends up in a situation at work where you don't have power. Like you don't, like, because at the, you have to go to lunch when they tell you to go to lunch. That's, you can't go to lunch when you feel like it, most people. You know what I'm saying? You have to abide by the laws. You know, you have to abide by whatever your job description is. You can't step outside of the lines at times, depending on your job. And I think that's the hugest difference between career and employment. Because when you're employed, you don't have power. You can't, like, especially if you're not on your own business.
I can't go to work
and be like, I'm going to lunch when I feel like it. Like, they'd be like, nah, we got people waiting. You can't go.
I would disagree with you on that. Only because maybe it's just my job experience. Like, your career is yours. You know what I'm saying? The path that you take, like, the way that I look at it and the way that I tend to see things is, I at all times, I'm my own boss. I'm an adult. I'm a grown-up. Don't nobody tell me when to do anything, how I could take this. No, I'm an adult. I'm a grown-up. I do what I want to do, and I do what I need to do to make sure that I continue to make, you know, make the money that I make. So the way that I look at it is the company that I work for is my client. You know what I'm saying? And just in customer service, you always try to make your client happy, right? So I'm working for the company I work for is my client. I'm my own boss. My career is in my own hands. At the point in which I'm like, oh, this isn't, my client isn't working or looking out for my best interest, you know, then I go look for a new client. You know what I'm saying? At the point where it's like I'm trying to build my career so that I have X amount of stats. And that's how I look at it. Like, okay, I've worked on so many projects worth so many billions of dollars. I've worked on, you know, I've worked for so many different big names. I've worked with, you know, so many different government entities. I have, you know, this certification, that certification. I have these things on my belt. Like, that's what you're looking at as you build yourself up as a career. You build yourself up as a business. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And at the end of the day, if my employer isn't trying to look out for what I'm trying to do as my own business, well, then see you. There's plenty of other employers out here that I can move to. So,
yeah,
that's how I keep that balance.
It's nice that you feel that way and that works for you, but that's not a lot of people. Because a lot of people aren't working in their field that they want to do. They're not doing what they love, or they don't find the enjoyment because they ended up in the situation and they really hate what they do. So, and I think you find it, you know, especially if you're working and you're only living paycheck to paycheck and you're always behind and you can't take off to see your kids and you can't do those things. So it's kind of hard for people to take those steps out.
That speaks to the subject. Is what's how do you empower yourself? You know what I'm saying?
Right.
If you're in a situation where you looking at it and you like, well, damn, I'm living paycheck to paycheck, which means either number one, you living above your means, or number two, you're working in a position where it doesn't meet your financial needs.
Right.
So
right.
You do one of two things. You either cut back on your expenses, or you get you find something that's going to pay you what you think you're worth. You find something that's going to pay you better. And here's the thing. Like, here's the thing most people don't realize. It's like, oh, well, you know, ain't nothing out there. There's always something out there. Well, I don't have the skills. Well, go get the skills. And that's your power.
Right.
Like, if you
right.
let things stop you, if you let these excuses stop you from
mm-hmm.
moving forward, from doing
mm-hmm.
the things, then you give up your power. And that's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people give up their power on a daily basis. You know, like,
mm-hmm.
you know,
absolutely.
I'll be on my political soapbox. And people looked at this
mm-hmm.
election and they got so downtrodden because President Pussy Grab came into power and they was like, oh, what am I going to do? We have President Pussy Grab that's at the top of the executive branch. And my whole outlook on it was, you know what? It don't matter who's in office, because at the end of the day, it's up to me to make life better for me and make life better
mm-hmm.
for the community that I live in. If I'm out here, if I'm being an example to the younger kids or the younger generations that's out here, if I'm giving back
mm-hmm.
into my community, if I'm being a positive person in my neighborhood, if I'm doing stuff to try to create businesses for myself or streams of
mm-hmm.
income for myself, then
mm-hmm.
that's what I got to worry about. But you know that the dude that's in the office and all, like, he going to try a lot of bullshit because he's in a seat in a position of power where he can institute a lot of bullshit and get away with a lot of bullshit. But at the end of the day, if I know, if I'm working to make sure that my community is tight, my community around me is tight, and my personal well-being and space is tight, then it don't matter who's in office. It really doesn't, because that bullshit stops at a certain level. You, like, he's so far up, his bullshit can't come all the way down. I'm in the weeds. His bullshit can't come all the way down unless I'm doing stuff that allows it to come down. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I got to rise
yeah.
to the level
it,
where I let his bullshit affect me. And as long as I keep
yeah,
doing the
it,
things
it,
that I'm supposed to be doing,
mm-hmm.
I'm just saying.
You know, that's... You know, that definitely, you know, that works for your situation, but it's definitely different for a lot of people. When you start talking about, you know, taking away funding for Meals on Wheels and stop taking away, and you need that financial power to get your food, or, you know, you start taking away nonprofits or the arts and the crafts, you feel powerless because
you
feel
do.
Like, you know, companies
but
feel
the
like
trick.
There's nothing you can do. So it's like, you know, in so many realms, yeah, I feel like you can control your own power and what you can be in control of, but you still have to constantly figure out ways
so,
to keep your power
so here's,
when you lose
here's
it.
The
I
thing.
Mhm.
Like the whole Meals on Wheels thing, like
mm-hmm.
we realize what it is. It's bullshit coming from the top. Where they're trying to really, to me, the way I see it, they're really trying to create a new slave class. And that new slave
mm-hmm.
class isn't necessarily based on, it's not necessarily based on the color of your skin. It's based on what's in your bank account. The haves and the have-nots. That's what the game has always been. That's what the game will always be about. So don't get it twisted. They use color of skin to create divisions amongst the people, because when you look at all these people that don't have, like, you think of community. If we are loving one another and looking out for one another, then we're not going to let our neighbor go without a meal. We ain't going to let our neighbor go without. We ain't going to let our neighbor struggle. But the society that we live in.
Right.
I'm saying the society that
yeah.
we live in, we've been fed this bullshit about, oh, you got to pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You got to.
Right.
People say God loves those that help themselves. It don't say that nowhere in the Bible at all. In any biblical
right.
text, God helps those that help themselves. That no, what it says is, love your brother like you love yourself. So if we are
right.
living by those principles of empowering one another, when we empower one another, we empower ourselves. And that's the trick of the enemy.
Right. And you know, and when it comes to, you know, those different layers of you know, funding and, you know, and who is in control, and, you know, it's a real, our society is so different now that the utopia is not like that anymore. So you have, some people have to rely, and a lot of people that get wheels on wheels are not Black. They're just unable to, they're elderly, or they're by themselves, they have no family, you know what I mean? So with these different programs and things, you know, these people who don't know when their next meal is coming from, or homeless shelters and all those other things, art, you know, and music and those cultural elements just in general, you know, it does trickle. But I do want to, you know, just do a quick transition from the presidential part, because there, and I just wanted to be a little transparent because I know how I do this every now and then. You know, I asked he, you know, has there been a moment where he felt powerless? I can say I had a moment where I felt powerless, and it happens because your life does not go the way that you plan, and you might go on and you feel like you have accomplished it all, you've done it all, you get to this level, and then all of a sudden, bam, it's like, whoa, I have no control over my life, because things drive you and things motivate you that look great and look beautiful, and then you start to neglect other things because you're driven by a power and you don't make the wisest decisions. And that's one of the reasons why I picked this topic, because Eric Jerome Dickey, a lot of his characters are driven by different forces of power, either having power sexually from the people that they engage with, or money, or hate, or jealousy, or envy, you know, these various levels of what drives you to get that power and get that next hit and get that next thing. And I can honestly say, you know, about 5 years ago, I thought I was in control of my life, and I wasn't. And it was a simple conversation that I had with a doctor, and she said, well, you know, Lee, you know, when was the last time you went to the movie? When was the last time you slept through the night without waking up? When was, you know, these various questions, and I could not answer the question. And it was like, whoa, I completely was on an adrenaline rush for a long time, and I completely lost power of what made me fully happy. And there's people out there that's in this situation right now who are struggling with not letting their money, not letting a fast life, not letting the quick paper, not letting sex, not letting their curiosity drive them to make these decisions that's not good for them, and it just deteriorates them down. So, you know, if you are in that space and you're going through this now, take a breather. Really sit back, assess what's going on, and think of those simple questions. When was the last time I smiled? When was the last time I was happy? When was the last time I had fun? When was the last time I slept for 8 hours? When was the last time I ate 3 meals a day? Well, you know, these basic things, because you'll find that power, or that you want to be successful. So you do all these things to be successful, and you step on people, and you hurt people, and you disrespect people, and you might cheat people, and you might do so many bad things just to get the next thing. And that's real life. People are really going through that now. So I just wanted to share that with, you know, the listeners, and be like, hey, if that's you and you're going through that, yo, you're not alone, and it's not normal. You should never get to the point where you think you got it all. You've neglected important things about your health, your life, your relationships, your family, all of that. And then you start crashing down, and then you feel like you don't know what to do. You feel like you're powerless, and you go through a mode where you're confused, and you're in the dark, and you're like, oh my God, you have an identity crisis, because you don't know how you've lost control, and you critique yourself, and you're unsure, and then you just have all these doubts and anxiety and all of this stuff. So that was me a couple of years ago. Like, and it's not a, and once you go through something like that, you become more aware, and you learn how to make better decisions, and you learn how to put yourself first, because that's a learned behavior. That's not a taught behavior. You can teach the kids to do that, but they have to go through it to learn it. Because they don't know. They might think they're doing the right thing by helping someone, but in reality, they help. You deteriorate because you're helping, and you deteriorate because you're helping, and you're sacrificing because you're helping. And the next thing you know, you don't know who the hell you are anymore. And that's the problem. That's when you lose power. So I wanted to share that because I felt like that really, if you know, a lot of people are struggling with that right now. Just saying. But that's real tough, man. It's serious. You know, people driven by sex. People out there just smashing everybody because they just like how it feels. And it's just deteriorating.
Yeah, but that's like, because that's that
you
power
know, they're driven
of,
by alcohol.
Of manipulation. That's that power of, you know what I mean? What the whole sex thing is like, damn, like, I made her come. Like, I never... She never got dick down like that. She ain't never had the business given to her like that. And if I give her the business like that, you know what I mean? She might get dickmatized. Like that's a real thing. There's chicks out here that get dickmatized. And they just like, oh my God, like he could be the worst dude in the world for you. But it's that power of pleasure that like I said, people give up their power on a daily basis to one thing or another. And it's like, like basically at the end of the day, it's like, who are you allowing to be your Lord? So if your Lord is pleasure, then you gonna let that dude with that good D come in.
Or that female with some big boobies
take
put
over.
It in your face. You know what I'm saying? Keep taking them in your face and you be like, Ooh, I like it. Your areolas.
I'm just saying, like you give power. you see power and you take power. It's understanding your position. Like when you understand who you are, then you know the power that you have, and you can move in any situation with authority. But that comes in understanding you. And the problem is, people just don't understand who they are.
It's true. We're talking about power, y'all. I'm just saying. It's real in these streets, and it's crazy because that is just real life. You know what I'm saying? It's like, look, you go through things, you struggle, you get driven by this force. You know what I mean? And it's just crazy how it just takes you on a roller coaster, and then you just find yourself in situations. You find yourself meeting people. You find yourself just going insane because you just can't control it. It's like a drug. You gotta get to that hit. You got that power struggle. You got that power surge and that fuel is on, and it's like, oh my gosh, like what's really good? You know what I'm saying? So it's a little crazy, but we're going to take a break and come back. We have more on the topic of power. Eric Jerome Dickey will be joining us shortly. And this is one of my new favorite songs. And this dude is an actor. He's a rapper. He's a singer. He's a writer. He's a comedian. He's all of that. His name is Childish Gambino. This is his performance name, not his actor name. But the name of the song is Redbone. It's the Mr. Francis T. And this week, we'll be back. spirit when I hear it. I hope y'all was feeling the vibe. It's the Mystery Experience with T, myself, and JT will be joining us shortly with some sports. But before we get into that, I mentioned we had a very, very special guest. He is with us. He was born in Memphis, Tennessee. He got his degree, which I didn't know, in like computer system technology. Then transitioned and was like, hey, I want to be a comedian. Then was like, hey, let me learn how to write stories and figure this thing out and develop characters. And then he was like, look, bam, my screenplay is out, cappuccino. Then bam, it was like, sister, friends and lovers, milk in my coffee. Just the other woman and Naughty and Nice and sleeping with strangers and enemies and then you got Gideon and all these wonderful stories. And this gentleman that I'm going to say his name shortly, he also is the author of a miniseries that's coming, you know, with Storm and Black Panther, which is real hot. That was new to me. I didn't know that. So, ladies and gentlemen, for the first time, welcome to the show, the one and only New York bestseller author, Eric Jerome Dickey.
What's up? Jumping back, it's like every time I hear that song, you know, I'm thinking of the movie Get Out, man.
Definitely.
Man, talking about Stay Woke, that, man. It was like, and it's so funny because as soon as the movie comes on, it's like, it's saying Stay Woke.
For real.
And if you had, I would have to say that movie was, for me, was a life changing experience, man. It was
I was going to ask you, as a writer, how did that hit you? Because to me, that was such an original piece. Like,
you know what?
I've never seen anything
like
that.
It's like he took. I'm trying to think. What was another movie? Like, oh, it would be like Hitchcock. If you've seen, back in the day when Janet Leigh and Anthony Perkins were doing Psycho, people came to the theater. They didn't know what kind of movie it was. They knew, you know, because it starts off, it seems like it's a movie about a woman who stole the money from a boss and is running away.
Right.
Halfway through the movie, it does a hard left and becomes something else. That's what Get Out does. That's what Get Out does. It starts off like it's going to be about, okay, white people, racism, we've seen it before. Then it makes a hard left, and it becomes a straight horror film, man. And I think, for me, the thing that was really horrifying about the experience would be you've been jacked, but you're in the sunken place, and you can still see what's going on.
Right.
You know what I mean? So you're not just totally wiped out. You're watching someone else control your body and just everything, man. That's like that's got to be you know.
But that's so real in a sense because it's people living like that every day.
Yeah,
they in a sunken place and they watching all this stuff going around them and
just
they know better.
Yeah,
they not doing nothing about it.
You know, and
feel powerless.
It's like I did Milk in My Coffee years ago, and I had a lot of stereotypes. Tried to bend a few stereotypes, but it was nothing like this. Nothing in this direction. Where it's just, I mean, to me, it was just brilliant. You know, I guess mine stayed true to life. His was just brilliant in that way where. You know, and I think it's the same thing. I've done this with novels, the same thing he's done with the film. First time you go through it, you think you understand what's going on, and then you realize, I misinterpreted everything that happened. And you got to go back for a second look to go like, you know, it's like you misinterpret every line of dialogue, and you realize that every line was important. They weren't just talking to be talking. Every time, you know, the small scene where he says, the kitchen was my mother's favorite place. We like to keep a piece of her in the kitchen.
Yeah. Right, and it was another part when he was like, my father, my grandfather lost to the runner, Jackie Robinson. I can't think of the name. And he was like,
And he never got over it. And he never got over it, man. Yeah, I'm sure it was a lot of
silence.
It was a lot of, coupled with, being black, you always have to interact with the mainstream world, the white world.
Mm-hmm.
Being white,
mm-hmm.
you don't have to interact with the black world. You can get through your whole
mm-hmm.
life being white, I assume, and you don't. Mm-hmm. You're not forced to buy a black product from a black business,
mm-hmm.
anything.
Mm-hmm.
If you're black, if you have your own bookstore, your books are probably coming from a white-owned company. If you buy paper, where is it coming from? If you buy ink, where is it coming from? So we have to, on every level, that's why the black dollar doesn't stay in the community that long. Because we are forced to go outside to get goods and services.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, but when we tried to stay within our community and procure goods and services, that got looked at as negative, and those instances were destroyed by
yeah.
the white community.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Oklahoma.
Yep.
Oklahoma, man. They doing too good on the other side of the railroad tracks, you know.
Right.
They over there minding their own business.
We damned if we do, we damned if we don't.
Because on another level,
yeah.
A lot of people can get away with stuff because they have the police department and the army behind them. Black people
mm-hmm.
in this country have never had a police department or an army behind them. Whenever we see them
mm-hmm.
coming, you know, it's going to be black heads busted. You know, that's
yeah.
just the way it is, you know.
Yeah.
It's never been, you know, it's just a totally different relationship. I mean, you know, even now, the president that's in the asterisk president that's in the White House
yeah.
now
yeah.
is, you know,
yeah.
he's talking about policing, you know, policing black communities, which we know what that means. That means, you know, that's more code for more mass incarceration.
You want to be
tough on crime, but it's like, yeah, you're not looking at the root of the problem. I mean, you know, jobs, money, finance. You know, nobody wants to be a stick up kid, but you know, if people who got money are chilling. I mean, if you get people, I believe people have jobs and they're thriving.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of that goes away. A lot of
yeah.
it goes away. But if you're constantly making it harder for people to get employed, to have a certain standard of living, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nobody wants to live at the bottom. No more, you know.
Yeah, nobody does.
That's the power dynamic of this country.
Yeah,
everybody wants to keep their piece of power.
Well, I want to be able to go to Florida every weekend and golf. You know.
Right. But you know what's cool though, Eric? Like, you in your career and all that you've done and all of the things that you've accomplished. Like, when people say black people don't read and people don't support authors and people don't do this, like, your following and those that have supported you from the very beginning. And I mean, you came out, you know, with your first book at a time when you had Terry McMillan and Omar Khadri,
yeah.
like all these.
It was like Terry McMillan, Bibi Moore Campbell, Connie
right.
Briscoe Hooks.
Yes.
But no, they little. We had a lot
yep,
of.
Yep.
A
lot.
Well, here's the thing. We
writers.
Had a lot of very, very well educated black women writing.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing novels when I
yes.
came out. I mean, I'm talking
yes.
about like, the wave before mine. I mean, they just amazing. I mean, just totally just
yes.
amazing, man. You know,
mm-hmm.
Tanatori Do was one of my favorites. Before I started writing, she does horror.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll never forget,
mm-hmm.
I was in this area called Leimert Park, which is African American area in LA, and I saw this book, The Between, and it had a blurb by Stephen King on it, and I had never read a horror novel with an African American as a protagonist.
Right.
Which sounds really like a small thing, but at the same time, it's a huge thing. And I remember reading it and just being like, oh, my God, this book should be number one. Why doesn't everybody know about this book, you know? And you know, but that was me, you know. It's like, oh, my God, you got to know about this book. Everybody should have this book. Read it. It's really good.
Right.
You know, so we have a lot of people who hear talent for whatever reason, marketing, falls through the cracks. I mean, I don't know, just it's a curious business at times. I mean, because you have stuff last year, year before last. I mean, you had a book out and everybody talked about how horrible it was, but it was a number one seller. But everyone was talking about it. They were buying it, but this is a horrible book. Go get it. I mean, that's basically what happened. Oh my God, did you read it? Did you read how bad it was? Get your copy, read it. You know, it's like, and that's basically what it felt like I witnessed. It was like, okay, I don't get it. I just don't get it, you know?
Yeah. And for you to have accomplished so much and have created so many characters, I always wondered, and I wanted to ask you this. Do you have a favorite character out of all of your books?
You know, usually it's whatever book I'm working on at the time. Right now, and you know, and the reason I said it because that'll be the last character I put a lot of energy into, and at that moment, the most familiar with. So right now it would be Gideon, the Gideon universe. There's so many characters in the Gideon universe I like, and what I like about the Gideon series is that Gideon is an assassin. He first shot someone when he was 7 years old. Went on a run with his mother, eventually became a hitman, eventually took on the name Gideon, and he has a lot of personal demons and family issues and relationship issues and just a lot of stuff that just, I think on one hand, despite what he does, he remains relatable to a lot of people. You know, he can't get... With all the stuff that he does, he still can't get what he wants. And he was a challenging character to write from the onset, simply because I was writing about somebody who was going to kill people. So for me and my sensibilities, which, you know, it's funny. It's like that goes against everything I believe in. But then I go like, yeah, get over it. You know, get over it and write the book. You know, get over it and write the book. You know. I wrote that first, like the first scene I wrote. I was like, oh my God, I just killed somebody. Then I go like, they're not real. They don't exist. You're gonna erase it. Look, erase a line. He's alive. He's back. You know, so erase. You know, Control Y, put it back. He's dead again. You know, but and that was challenging for me. I mean, to come up with a character, and not just that. This is his occupation. Gun for hire, wet works, an assassin, whatever you call it. But the way he does what he, the way he handles himself, the way he completes each assignment has to be different. So this isn't one where you're going to read about. And the reason I did that because before I started working on Gideon, I was reading an assassin series that I really enjoyed, nitpicking, the only thing I didn't like about it was every time he did a job, he did it the exact same way. I mean, so,
like, oh, that's a signature.
That signature would mean that everybody knows, and that just would lead to somebody getting caught.
That's what I thought too. You know, and he did local jobs, you know, by where he lived, and it was always, you know, the same type of. So, like, if you use a 38, every job was done with a 38. Every job was done with a 38, and I was kind of like, well, the guy I come up with isn't going to do that. So every time he does something, it's different. So Gideon has done stuff from, he's shot people, he's thrown people out of planes, he's throwing people out of windows. He's, you know, just every time I come up with something, it's just try to come up with something just slightly different. You know what I mean? Slightly different.
Right.
So, you know, so if you had 20 crimes and you put them side by side, it would look just like 20 random crimes. You know, it's not going to be like 20 crimes. Like, well, they were all done with a 38. Maybe they're connected, you know.
Right. Maybe it's the same person. It was
yeah, you know, and also with the... And also within Finding Gideon, which is the sequel to Resurrected Midnight, which came out quite a while ago at this point. All the other characters, I mean, years ago I read Stephen King's Green Mile, and one of the things I loved about it was how he had this population of everybody was from someplace different. I mean, you have someone black, someone's Creole, someone from the Midwest, different races, different nationalities, and I've kind of done that with the Gideon series. So I have Gideon, I have Russians, I have Filipinos, I have French, I have Africans, I have, you know what I mean? So it's not that, it's not the friends and lovers, everybody in Baldwin Hill, everybody's black, middle class, buppy, crowd, which is a good crowd, but I'm just saying it's a different, and the way I see it, and I did the same thing with Tempted by Trouble, because the way I see it is I'm creating a character. It's about who has a particular skill set. It's not about nationality. So if you're a Native American woman and you got the skills to handle this job, you got the job. That's it. So it's not about gender. It's not about nationality. It's just about who's got a particular skill set, you know.
Right.
And with that, I mean, it's been really interesting just coming up with this cast of characters that, this is so funny, as deadly as they are, they will probably still hang out and do karaoke, you know. I mean, they will. I mean, they go dancing, they go to dinner, they do this, you know, they probably do karaoke. I mean, it's, you know, because I think because part of it is the extreme is regardless of what they do, they still want to be normal. They still want to be loved. They still want to have someone who's got their back, to have somebody's back. It's in a whole different way, you know what I mean? And if it goes, and if stuff goes south, you know, I'll go on the run with you. You know.
Let's roll out. Let's
roll, right. Let's roll out. This is it, you know. But so this is. I mean, I've really enjoyed it. I mean, even the novel before this, Blackbirds. I mean, four African American women, with three African American, one is actually African. Basically, living out loud. I mean, the opening of Blackbirds is you've got four women of color jumping out of a plane. You know, which just lets you know it's like for them, life is an adventure. You know, they want to get out and do stuff. They were before they get serious, before they get married, before they have kids. It's like they just have this bucket list of things, you know, jumping out of planes, snorkeling, bungee jumping, you know, just all this stuff that they want to do just to do it, you know.
And these are things that black women should be doing, you know what I'm saying? And that's
these are things that black women do. These are things that black women do. It's not shit. I mean, they do this. I mean, I know these people. I mean, to a certain extent. I mean, not everybody does it, but I know people.
Right.
Snow skiing, snowboarding, jumping out of planes. I mean, water skiing. I know black women. You walk into the house, they got a surfboard in the corner.
Right.
I know a black woman with the shorts. And I was crazy?
Yeah.
Like,
I mean,
you're trying to get in the water with a great white.
Say it again.
She wants to get in the water with a great white in the cage. Didn't you see animals attack? That's like hard coating rapper, so I don't know if I'm that brave.
And I got to tell you, I'm not that brave because for me, it's sort of like I get into the oxygen tank. I start to get claustrophobic, so I'm like, nah, this doesn't work for me. So
This ain't doing it.
Nah, I'm just not comfortable right now. I need to be above the ground, you know. But,
yes.
But yeah, I mean, but I love I love having characters do having an adventure, doing things, and then and as you're reading it, you like the characters. Hopefully, you have empathy for what they go through. You may not agree with their decisions, but you know where it comes from. And so, you know what I mean? So it's like your friends. You know, they your friends do something. I don't agree with you, but you know what? I got your back. You're my dog.
Right.
All right. I don't agree.
Right.
I wouldn't do that. But all right. But that's your choice. I got your back. You know.
That's your choice.
yeah. You know, and if it goes south, you know, you there to. All right. Let me take you to Roscoe Chicken and Waffles, and we can sit down and talk this through. You know that.
Right.
You know. Yeah,
right.
You know. Yeah.
And you know, like, with all of your characters, they're all definitely very, like, you might love them, hate them, want to choke them, want to hug them. You know, they all have their, and they're relatable. Like you can be like, I know someone that acts like that, or I know someone that does, you know, does that. You know, but when you decided to do Storm, you know, the
miniseries that did for Marvel.
Yes, especially now that Marvel and, like, comics, and you got the Black Panther movie coming out, and there's all this buzz between all, you know, with all these superheroes, you know, and that came out, what, almost 10 years ago? It's been a while, man.
It came out, I remember I was working on Chasing Destiny at the time, so, and Destiny went from being a teenager to an adult, so it's been a while, yeah.
What was that like? And now that are they looking at bringing that back to the forefront? I don't know
what they're doing, because the Marvel Universe, so far as the Black Panther, has changed so much. It's changed a lot. They have a great series running now. They've done a couple of reboots on the Black Panther series. It's like
Storm and Black Panther got a divorce.
Yeah, they did. I mean, during I believe that was during Civil War.
Or it was Avengers versus X-Men. That's where they ripped.
Yeah, and, you know, and the thing I didn't like about that was just the fact that they had Black Panther and Storm get into a physical fight.
Yeah.
And I guess it's just me as a black man. I was like, I just didn't want to show him putting
balls on
her. You know what
like
I mean?
That.
Huh?
Yeah.
You don't see it happening like that. That's your woman. That's your boo. Y'all the most powerful black people in the Marvel Universe.
Exactly.
I just didn't sit well with me.
You know what I mean? I was just I just don't want to see them fight, you know, and it's such
because
T'Challa is just too intelligent for that. I would think, you know what I mean? And Storm too. I mean, I don't know. It just rubbed me the wrong way. You know what I mean? It just.
Yeah.
I would have tried to find some other creative way to do it without them actually. I probably would have done this. This is just off the top of my head. I would have given them a common enemy to fight together.
Right.
And while they're fighting, they're breaking up. You know,
oh,
while they got each other.
Right.
So while they're saving each other, protecting each other, they're still arguing, and they break up. And then once they defeat the enemy, then they face each other. So, well, I guess we're done. Yeah, I guess we're done. Then they go one, go left, one, go right. I would have done it that way. Say it again.
I can see that. Like on some opposite of Mr. and Mrs. Smith.
Like that. Yeah, like how they didn't know it was against each other, but then they had to fight together, but then they hated each other, but then it's like, whoa, we got to
move. They got two different ideas on how they should take care of a common enemy.
Exactly.
And both of them have balanced
points
of how they should do it.
Yes,
but,
I don't think I would have done the panel where they, you know, they're duking it out, man. I'm just like, all right, you know, but those are two characters who are very powerful in the Marvel Universe that they've never really know what to do with simply because they're black. Because I remember when the Marvel Universe first kicked off, and this was before Black Panther was the Black Panther movie was in production or being worked on or cast or whatever. Someone had said that they didn't do Black Panther because it would be too difficult to create Wakanda. But you created a Thor's crib.
Yeah.
just like you say some stuff and you go like that don't make no sense. So why would that be so difficult to create? I mean, but I think it's going to surprise them. I mean, you got this huge, amazing cast with Black Panther, and they don't realize how many sisters are into cosplay and everything else.
Yes.
Oh yeah, man.
Yes.
Oh yeah, and that's
the only reason.
See, and the only reason a lot of sisters haven't participated or shown up or commented on a lot of stuff because there was no black people in it. So, you know, and I think that a lot of time they think that if we put a black guy in there, that satisfies all the black people. No, you got to put a black woman in there. And I do mean a black woman that looks like a black woman. So, I mean, like you can't take Storm from the comic and make her look like Halle Berry. Storm needs to look like Storm.
Yeah.
It's almost it's like the 50s, man. We see a dark skinned black woman on TV. Everybody come run. Look, we got a dark skinned black woman. I mean, that's why, you know, cuz you know, especially in a role where she's fully realized. She's not the best friend. She has a love life. She has sex. She has everything that the white women have. You know what I mean?
Right.
know what I mean? She's not the shoulder to cry on. She's not the one who can't keep a man or don't want a man or don't, you know, she's not sexless. I mean, just...
That's your girl,
Sherry
Washington.
And she's fully powerful. And that's the thing with Storm, and she's definitely X-Men is one of my favorite comic series as a whole. But like one thing I identified, you know, when reading the comics growing up, my dad had comics and all this. Like, she's powerful. Like her force is like a whole nother level, and it was always downplayed on like the movies and the cartoons, and but when you read the comics and her coming from the motherland and. Yeah, right.
I mean, really, she could just wipe out a city if she wanted to. I mean, she's got the, it, man.
Like,
I mean, you know.
The mind is one thing, but the fact that she can completely wipe out countries, land, you know, she can control every part of the elements of the earth. It's like,
that's it,
so
man. And she can ride the wind. I mean, it's like, man, are you serious? I mean, she could
right.
Man, just... But again, she has that.
But it's that image of power.
Jean Grey level power, but they've never really.
Yeah.
You know, just imagine if she. You know, it's so funny because when I did the comic, if you read the comic, if you see it, in the probably in the first issue in the origin, there's a plane about to crash into their apartment. They're in the Middle East, and a plane crashes into her apartment, and it kills her mother and her dad, and she's buried alive. Storm is, which is why she's claustrophobic. But there's a moment because her mother dyes her hair. Her mother dyes her hair black, and there was a moment where her mother sees the plane coming, and I wrote it where her mother actually turns. And her mother actually has some of the same power, and she blows Storm across the room, and she lands inside of a chest. So I tried to do it like her mother had hints of the same power, but her mother was running away from her mother, you know, because her mother was black in the 60s, civil rights, just don't want she just didn't want to be different, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's different if you're a white guy in a mask and you're saying, like, I'm here to save you, and you're a black guy in a mask. It
right.
just doesn't really play out the same.
It doesn't play the same.
Nah, man. I mean, they have never complained about the Klan in the hoods, but Black Panthers and some sunglasses. I can't see your eyes. I can't see your eyes.
Oh,
but the dude
geez.
In the white
yes.
hood, oh, never mind. It's just laundry day. He's on the way to get his stuff clean. Never mind. That's my cousin.
Oh, Jesus.
Just saying,
that is
you know,
so true.
It's a different set of rules. I'm just saying, man.
It's a different
you know,
set of
like,
rules.
Dude,
absolutely.
Different set of rules, man. I mean, you know.
Absolutely.
But the thing is and a lot of white people, they have no idea the duality of our lives, how we have
mm-hmm.
to live the black life, and then when we have
mm-hmm.
to go into mainstream and interact, how we have to conform to their standards to a certain degree.
Right.
Yeah.
And I mean, and women, black women, I mean, have had it the worst. I mean, to me, I mean, you know, all the hate on your hair, it's
yes.
just freaking, it's just ridiculous, man.
Yes.
From the boat up until, I mean, it's just ridiculous, man.
It's just
the stuff that you see a woman that got the hot comb, the perm,
mm-hmm.
the all this stuff that in the end that damages
it
everything.
Deteriorates everything.
Yeah,
yeah it does.
You know,
it has
so
much. So, but
yeah, just you know, because you're trying not to look too black.
Ideal. Yep. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah,
you
yeah.
want to fit in,
yeah,
and
I mean,
perform and.
But you'll never fit in. You'll never fit in.
Right.
I mean, it doesn't matter
right.
what you do. You never.
Yeah, but the crazy thing is now these white women are trying to get the curves like the black women.
Oh yeah.
They're going through
yeah.
the things of getting the butt implants, the lip
oh, yeah.
injections,
right.
and
yeah,
all
I remember
of that.
Yeah, I like where a lot of that started. Yeah, the collagen in the lips, the this, the that. I mean, and they are literally dying trying to enhance, you know, themselves. But you know, but at the same time, you know, you've got to be convinced that something is wrong with you. To
mm-hmm.
I mean,
to make those changes.
Yeah,
something has somehow.
Well, here's the thing. I mean, and this might be true. I mean, I'm just making this up. You know. White woman walking down the street with a man, and black woman walking by, and white man look at the black woman, and the white woman, hey, what are you looking at? Well, she's thinking, I need to get some booty like that, then so he can look at me. I don't know, but
like
it's just
yeah.
I don't know. It's just really you've seen it change, and the things that well, it's like this. It's like we've known black women with particular body types all our lives, but then someone who's white, mainstream, looks white, has that, and then they're praised
mm-hmm.
like they were the first one ever and they created it. You
mm-hmm.
know, it's like,
yeah,
wow,
like,
you know.
Like a Kim Kardashian.
I wasn't calling no names, but go ahead.
Yeah, yeah, I'm gonna put it out there.
Well, I mean, you know, she's pretty and this, that, and the other, but still at the same time, I'm like, yeah, but I know some sisters you can't hold a candle to, so I just, you know, but it's when it's packaged differently, it's treated differently.
Yeah.
So,
like,
in my opinion.
Put braids
I mean,
in her hair.
Yeah,
when Bo Derek
yeah,
put
yeah,
braids
yeah.
in her hair.
Yeah,
like,
yeah,
oh,
yeah,
my goodness,
yeah.
that's the best thing. Let's go get braids.
Oh yeah, you know, because I'm up and down in the islands, man. You know, when you get off on the, if you're coming on a cruise ship, the moment you get off,
mm-hmm.
there's a stand with women braiding hair, and
yep.
they, and people love to get
right
their hair braided on vacation. Yeah, right off the boat, they're standing right there. It's like, oh my god,
right
you know. Oh yeah,
yep.
you know. Oh yeah, you know. Mm-hmm. So they can do all this, you know. And it's funny watching people on vacation, do the things that. When they go back to work, they're going to criticize Keisha for having, you know.
yeah.
Well, you know, it's just not professional for her hair to be like that, you know. And then, you know,
yeah.
then I mean, it's just, you know, just my observation. I don't mean to belabor the point of beat it up, but it's just really, it's just interesting to watch. If the president's wife walked out with cornrows on, they would just oh my gosh, she's so fashion forward. She's taking a risk. Look at her.
Melania, she's so beautiful.
Oh,
she's so beautiful the way she does that. Melania
Yeah, it's just kind of like, you know, just kind of like the way.
It's a lot of double standards.
It is. I mean, because when you're in the, it is. I mean, and it's always. I was in the Bahamas, so this would have been about the time I was working on the first Gideon, but it would have been like 2009, 2010, and at the time on Paradise Island, at the hotel on Paradise Island, please Paradise Island.
This sounds right. Where Atlantis
is.
If
you were black and you worked there, you couldn't have dreadlocks. Your hair had to be straight or cut short. And it's funny, it's like, so basically we got white people who come to the Bahamas and they want black people who don't look like black people.
Right.
I was like, wow. So I said, this is your island and to work at this hotel. And so, yeah, so you had a lot of people who had, you know, 10, 12, 14 years of dreadlocks, man, you know, cutting their hair all off, man. I was like, wow. Yeah, cut it off. And it had to be certain this, certain that. It had to be straight. Or I was like, wow. I was like, I'm in the Bahamas, man.
Right.
I'm like, wow.
I can't even enjoy the naturalness of what I'm supposed to see when I come here. When I go into town, I can't see that on the resort because it's the image that people want to portray, which is,
I think a lot of stuff is we, and this could be a big stretch or bad perception, is we deal with what the white man is comfortable with. The white man set the standards. If you don't like your hair, then you got to change your hair. And
so
I think for a lot of
giving up our power.
They've given up power
to get what in return.
Yeah.
That's my question. We're giving up power to get.
I don't
what
think anybody
return.
Knows.
Nobody
I think
knows.
People,
no, I'm just.
I don't think no one knows. It's like the Matrix. You take the red pill or the blue pill, and you
blue
figure
pill,
out
yeah.
which pill you keep taking.
You're right. You know.
You know.
You're right. You know, because I can see with me, just like on my journey from having short hair when I was an engineer, software. Like you say, I worked in software development. I had short hair. Then I became a writer. Then I had that kind of freedom where it was just, I don't have to cut my hair if I don't want to. So I didn't.
Right.
So I had dreadlocks, you know. But on that journey, it was interesting watching the way people reacted to me. I haven't changed, but the way people reacted to you changed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was like, I remember I have a friend, she's white, and I hadn't seen her in a long time, and then she came to an event, and I had dreadlocks. And her look was kind of like, oh, you're one of them. I never forget that look, man. You know, it was like, oh my God, you've got dreadlocks. How long are you gonna let those grow? Until they don't grow anymore. I mean, really. So it was that kind of, you know, same dude, different hairstyle, but you know, yeah. I mean, but it just really does. You know, it does a lot of power in hair, man. I mean, and probably because that's the. First impression, maybe.
Yeah.
And people don't know you. They judge you. They judge you wrong.
That's
you
it.
And
that's it.
So.
You know, it's always a weird stigma, and you know, and I've learned that with myself. I've been natural for about 3 years now, and I work in a corporate place, and today I was do some twist up in the front, and I every time I go to work, my manager, she look at me kind of off, you know, I be looking like whatever, like I don't care, like it is what it is. My customers, they love me, it's all good, but I know the
difference. So do you find that as a source of your power though, Lee? Like do you look at like my hair is my power? Because that's my thing.
It is, man.
His power was in not cutting his locks. But he got in with the wrong people, and, you know, Delilah was like, yo.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and the thing with hair is hair makes you look – fertile or masculine or healthy. You know, I mean, it's a very thing. I mean, if you see someone who has, and here's the thing, I've never used the word, well, in my adult years, nappy. Because to me, it's always strong hair. It's always been strong hair. I mean, you've got, and the reason I said it, because my hair has always been weak. So I know people who had strong hair, and I was envious of them because I wanted my hair, I wanted to be able to have a good afro. You know what I mean?
Wait.
I had to throw that, I get a blowout, I start to sweat, it shrivel up. Damn, you know, it's been wasted $20, you know.
Right.
But, you know, I wanted the strong hair, you know. And you can perm your hair, you can straighten your hair, you got good strong hair, man. You know, shit. You know, and if you got good strong hair, and it don't want to take a perm, guess what? It ain't supposed to be permed.
Right.
Because you're putting something not natural in it, and it's rejecting it.
Right.
It's
absolutely
not supposed to be permed. It was
absolutely
the way it was supposed to be.
Supposed to be that way. Absolutely.
That's it. I mean, you know.
It's true.
I've always been, oh gosh, man, it's like one of those Pam Grier big afros that, you know, man, strong hair. Man, what? Strong, healthy hair, man. That's it. That's, you know.
Yep.
It's not that, you know, it's commercial for the, oh, is your hair thin and brittle? Nah.
It's a source of freedom. You know, now that I've been natural, I don't care. I go out in the rain, it gets wet. I'm like, all right, it is what it is. Like, ow. You just like, it is.
Wait, but that's what happens when you go natural, isn't it? It's like, now it's raining. It's not, it rain is no longer, it's not a game changer anymore.
It's not a game changer. It's really not. You just be like, oh, okay, it'll get wet. It'll curl up a little bit more. It'll be prettier. I'm cool with the rain.
You walk through the rain, you walk into the place, your hair a little wet, you keep it moving. I mean, that's it, you know. Oh, yeah,
exactly.
Oh, yeah. And knowing that, it's like, you know, because you know how it is, like, you know, when you got the perm and this, and you're having sex, you'd be like, okay, look, just don't mess up my hair.
I'ma sweat it out. Oh my God.
See, and that's why that's why it's so many 2 minute black men, because sister wanted them done in a minute and a half so the hair didn't sweat. That's what happened.
You
were turned to a
I can't put it on that.
I'm just making up stuff as I go along. That's all right.
Look, I mean, that's all good, because at the end of the day, well, you only wanted 1 minute, so she only wanted 1 minute. I need a full 60 minutes. So.
Word. Now you know if you go to full 60 minutes, she's going to look at you and say, you paying for my hair?
Who's
going to hold a full 60 minutes. You know, when she walk out, everybody can look at it and go, yeah, you went the full 60, you know. A sister with natural hair, you can't tell.
Nope, it don't matter. Go ahead. Pull your finger through. Go ahead and pull it out. You ain't going to feel no track. You ain't going to feel
no track. You know what I'm saying?
Out.
You know,
cool.
that is something you never heard a sister with a perm say, pull my hair.
Right. Man, I'll pull my hair. Do it. You know what I'm saying?
Right, because even if it's Thursday before she got that appointment, she don't want you to pull it because they're going to make the perm burn.
Right. Don't snatch it. Don't do that. Just keep it on my shoulder. Keep your hands on my shoulder.
Oh, just for that, I get on top.
Right.
Let me get on top. That's why I'm supposed to be holding your hands.
Right. That's right.
No, you can't be pulling at me.
Control.
No, just we good right here.
I need the control.
I got a question for you. Like,
go ahead.
You're so prolific. You're so prolific in your writing and how you do it. Mm-hmm. Do you ever run into writer's block? And if you do, how do you burn past that?
Well, you know, it's like every book I've had, I guess what you could call writer's block, where I got to a point where I've plotted out so far that I use up all the ideas. And shoot, man, it's kind of hard to explain. One thing I'll do is I'll go back to the beginning, reread, look for missed opportunities, try to make sure that I'm going in the right direction. Sometimes writer's block is like you just went in the wrong direction for a minute. You know, here's a simple one. It was I had done this book, Drive Me Crazy, with this character Driver, and there was a scene in there where when I had first written it, he had gotten into a fight, he had been kidnapped, they had thrown him into this trunk of this car, and they had wrapped his hands and feet in duct tape. So I sat there for 2 weeks going, like, how the hell is he going to get out of duct tape? I'm because
right.
And then someone said, oh, he just pulled his hand real hard. I was like, you don't know duct tape. That doesn't work. And the moment I put that into a book, everybody's going to call BS on that because you can't do that with duct tape, you know. So, I mean, I sat there for like 2-3 weeks just like, okay, what? And I just, you know. So what I did was I backed up and I changed the scene to where it was a rush job and they used this character's scarves to tie his hands up instead of duct tape.
Mm-hmm.
So, which enabled him to get away because it happened on the public street and it made sense. But you know, sometimes you write in something and it's just impossible to move forward. You've made a bad choice. You know, sometimes you need to examine a choice and it's like it's just not going to work. I've done stuff where the way I fixed it was I did a time jump. You know, I jumped from where I finished writing to what I knew I wanted to happen later on, and then just left the gap in between.
The middle part,
and,
right.
Just left it blank. So you know, you don't like they do in the movies. You know, 6 weeks later, all right. You know, it can be so many different things. I mean, it can be bad planning. I've actually started writing stories. Years ago, that what it turned out was I didn't have the skill set to write that story yet.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So I had to grow as a writer and Drive Me Crazy was one of those stories. I could not have written Gideon when I first started out because I wouldn't have known how to treat the story. I hadn't traveled enough. Because Gideon traveled. I hadn't traveled enough. I didn't know France and Belgium and Amsterdam the way I did by the time I wrote Gideon, so I could actually create this character who moved through all these exotic places, you know. It just really, really depends. I mean, because when I hear writer's block, it can mean so many things. I mean, and also it could be this, where you are in life. Sometimes your mind is so in some other place that you just have to go there. Just put the book down and go there and deal with it and come back. Because writers, we have to write through everything, man. We write through illness. We write through, weddings, funerals, everything, man. I mean, you know, because what happens with us is this is basically what happens is like, you know, so, oh, my best friend died. And they're like, oh, sorry to hear that. Is the book going to be on time? Okay, all right. Yeah, the book is going to be on time. But really, that's how it is. I mean, that's kind of like how it is. You know, it's like, oh, I broke my leg. Yeah, so will you have the book in by Friday? You know? I mean, it's and some people don't do well with deadlines.
Procrastination is not a good thing.
Your first book, you've had all of your life to work on your first book. By the time you show it to a publisher, there's no telling how long you've worked on it. It could have taken you 5 or 6 years, 7, 10 years to finish your first book.
I know that feeling. I'm still trying to finish my first one.
But see, what happens is now you've got your first book in, now your second book is due in a year.
Yeah.
And for a lot of people,
it's
just,
deal.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. they can't produce at that rate, because what happens yeah. is, like myself, Victoria Christopher Murray, Kimberla Lawson Roby, Rashonda Billingsley Tate, and others, always working. Always working. Mm-hmm. I've known them for 2 decades. All of us always mm-hmm. working. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It doesn't stop. You know, by the time that you turn in your book, it's time to start working on the next book. There's mm-hmm. no, like in the movies, that they will show, like, oh, someone turns in a book. The next day, it's a number one bestseller. They're living
right.
a life of champagne and caviar on the beach. They're doing nothing. Then at some point, the editor shows up on the beach because this person is so important that the editor leaves the publishing company in New York to fly down to Antigua to be on the beach to ask them, so are we gonna, when's the next book? Where's the next book? We need that next book, you know. And they write it in a week.
No, that's not real life.
They do, they write it in a week, but it's like they turn it in and the editor says, it's perfect. I'm not changing a thing. It doesn't work that way in the real world.
Yeah.
It's just you know, it doesn't work that way. You turn your book in, you get so many notes. I get so many notes. I get a lot of notes, and I look forward to the notes because I want everything questioned on the front end. No matter how
Absolutely.
Large, no matter how small, I want everything. Because what happens is, and you can't do it with ego. I mean, you gotta, you know, you need, you know, because what happens is, if you don't address this stuff, these are the reasons why people will say your book sucks. You know, like, oh well, yeah, no one can rip apart duct tape, you know.
Right.
So I stopped believing the book yeah. right there. You know, someone needs to come in and say, no, you can't do that with duct tape. You know, rethink this or redo this scene or something like that.
And your history and all that you've done, I mean, it's, you know, and you, I would say you're definitely an expert not only in that, because, you know, it's something that you learn along the way. I mean, even
yeah.
in the series with Finding Gideon, like from the first one, you know, because this is like the fifth one in the series, right? This is the fifth Gideon.
This is the fifth Gideon.
The fifth Gideon. So,
yeah,
you know,
fifth one, strangers waking with any enemies. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, so you learn it throughout the process, and it just makes you better, and you keep learning, and you keep growing, and I think
yeah.
that's
yeah.
what learning and mastering your craft is all about. And
Indeed.
If you don't want to put in the work and humble yourself to take the feedback and be better, then you're not doing it for the right reasons. You're doing it for another purpose. And
it is.
Some
people just want to
right.
be praised. Some people simply
right.
want to be praised.
Absolutely.
They want to do something. Yeah, but
right.
I've been in classes where I've seen those type of people, and it's ugly. It's ugly. I mean,
yeah.
in the sense that, you know, all they want is for you to tell them how good they are. They're not there
yeah.
for constructive criticism.
Yeah.
I remember sitting, I took classes at UCLA, and I always did the same thing. I submitted
mm-hmm.
my work, and it was a class of 13 or 14 people. And
mm-hmm.
when they gave their feedback, no matter what they said, you know, I took notes, no matter how ridiculous I felt it may have been, but that was that person's perspective, and they could be right. You know,
right.
I have to take that
right.
in mind. They could be right, because my job is communication, and
mm-hmm.
if it was misinterpreted, then I was not an effective communicator. If I did not
mm-hmm.
evoke the intended emotion, I was not an effective communicator. You know what
mm-hmm.
I mean? So it's like
mm-hmm.
if this movie is supposed to be a comedy and nobody's laughing, well, yeah, you missed
your
mark.
You haven't done your job.
Right, or
right.
it's supposed to be a drama, but everybody's laughing. Yeah, you did something way off, because they're not supposed to be laughing at this. Yeah, I mean,
right.
so I'm, and I would always do this. I would take all the notes, and I learned, never defend yourself. Never
mm-hmm.
defend yourself. You know, never think, no, this is what you're supposed to get out of it. But no, I just took the notes, And I always told them, thank you very much. And that was it.
Yeah.
And I took the notes and I went back, and what I could use, I used. What I couldn't use, I didn't.
Yeah.
I didn't, you know, because I've seen people in class almost become violent. Because someone did not like their work.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really, I've seen it. I'm sitting there going, mm-hmm. like, wow, that is ugly.
That is ugly.
And I've seen writers who were in class, who were published, who showed up with their published books, you know, in their hand to sort of like, I'm better than you kind of thing.
Because,
you know what I mean?
That ego.
And then, and then in class write the worst prose ever. And you're looking at it going like, But that's a good thing about class. So you get, you deal with 13, 14 people who normally, you wouldn't read their stuff, but as part of your assignment, which is really good because now you have to read fantasy, you have to read autobiography, you have to read mystery, you have to read relationship, you know what I mean? So, you know.
You have to widen your scope.
Yeah, you do. And everyone's style is so different. But the thing is, regardless of the genre, what works, works. That's it.
Yep.
I mean, a great opening to a story, clarity, a story that moves. It may not be the story that type of story that you would necessarily read, but you recognize this is good. This is really good.
Yeah.
This is really good. Yeah.
That's why everybody needs to go get Finding Gideon on and pick it up on April 17th.
Get it.
Get Resurrected Midnight and Dying for Friends and Walking with Enemies and Sleeping with Strength. Get the whole Get It. Learn all about Gideon.
With that said, are there any young authors that you're checking for? Like, who's caught your eye as far as, They're next up.
Let's see. I don't know who's next up. I've been following. In fact, I can find her name on Lexi Media. I'm trying to think of her name. She's about to drop a book. It's nonfiction, and I'm usually all up in her feed, and I cannot find her right now. Intellectual Media. Is this the only day she hasn't tweeted, really? Let's see if I can find her. But anyway, she did a great thing on she does these 2-minute history videos, and she's a blogger, and she did this thing that aroused a lot of people. I will just use the word aroused as opposed, so I won't say it, so it won't sound negative, about how. People say let go of slavery, but they don't let go of 9/11. And she does stuff point by point. I mean, and her book is about to drop. I think it drops. Where is she? I've got to pull her up since I've mentioned. I can't find her. And her book drops this week, as a matter of fact. And I'm so sorry. Oh, gosh. I'm trying to shout her out, and she is usually – I'm scrolling through Twitter as I do this. Hey, I see you guys. Hey. and she's usually here all the time. And I can't find her. I'm sorry about that, man. Oh, that really sucks. But I've been following her, waiting for her books to drop because I think she's doing – 20 points of history, 20 events in history or something like that. And, you know, she hits history from that, this is what they don't teach you in school point of view, you know, not the, no, because, you know, the stuff we get, I mean, it's just like, if you came from another universe and you came to America, you would think that, okay, black people have always been slaves.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Ain't good for nothing.
That was oh gosh, and if you, I mean, and if you saw the original Birth of a Nation, you know, the white people version,
yeah,
that was endorsed by the president at the time.
That's true.
That led to, you know, it's funny because I read somewhere it says like post slavery, the opinion of black people of slaves were they were dependable, they worked hard, they were trustworthy, blah 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 blah. And somewhere along with Birth of a Nation, everything changed. We became they changed the narrative. So basically, they changed the narrative to be able to incarcerate. They create more laws to be able to incarcerate.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
Able Supermanage the 13th kind of breaks it down for you.
Oh, yeah.
That documentary was phenomenal.
Oh, right. Man. Yeah. I saw that, man. T, isn't this crazy? Me and you standing on the corner, we can go to jail because we loitered. We just stand here chopping it up.
Right.
We just
right.
stand there chopping it up. Two black guys standing on the corner is loitering. Two white guys, they're having a meeting. So,
right.
I mean, they've created laws to criminalize
what we do.
Behaviors, like walking down the railroad track.
Mm-hmm.
The only way to get from point A to point B, because you're walking down the railroad track, you don't have to walk through white people neighborhood. You're safer.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, but they criminalize that. And if they, well, here's the thing. They won't give you a job. Then if they stop you, you don't have a job, you go to jail. But you won't give me a job.
Right.
But that
I mean,
was the thing. It was because they didn't want us to migrate to the north where there were possible jobs. And at the same time.
Oh, yeah,
because
they still needed us for the crops. They still needed you for the crops,
right.
man. They still
exactly.
needed you for the crops. So, I mean, that was it, man. And just too bad that it was just. There was nowhere that we could just that back then that every freed man and woman could just go and start their own society. And but the thing is, there was nowhere to go. You were cut out from Africa. You were so many generations from Africa that
our community was so decimated at that point.
Yes.
At the time of release from slavery, we didn't have nobody to say this is what family should be because our families
right.
were torn apart. They
right,
were ripped up.
Right.
We didn't have nobody to say this is how you act in civilized society because
right.
we were so used to fighting and scrapping to grind to the bottom to get to the bottom.
Right.
At the end of the day, you let us go. We're supposed to get 40 acres and a mule, and here we are in 2017 still looking for 40 acres and a mule. But the way some of us look for it is through bottles, through crack, through drugs, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Like we ain't never got our reparation.
Right.
That's
no, you're not. I mean,
reparations, Lord.
Well, you've never got an apology.
Yeah.
Right.
Hey, that's a whole other situation.
But it was funny. It's like, but the slave owners were given money for the slaves they lost, but the slaves, the people who had been enslaved for generations, got nothing.
Yeah. It's
because
of
our structure of the United States. And that's the thing a lot of people don't want to realize is our power structure in the United States is built on race and class.
Oh, yeah, man. Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, but isn't it funny as how the people who they fled England to get away from a certain type of behavior and came here and did the same thing.
They left England to escape the power structure of the church and of the monarchies.
Yes.
They came here and they instituted power structure based on wealth. Which is the same as monarchy.
Because in the beginning, you had to be a landowner to be able to vote in the beginning, right?
Correct.
You had to own land to be able to vote, yeah.
Yeah.
We've come so far.
We got so much more to go, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah,
we've
got a long way to go. Until the black woman is making equal pay with the white man.
Yes.
Until then, I mean, and that's...
That's like 30, 23. You let a black woman be on par with a white man, just equal pay for the same job, just in general.
They're not doing that. But I have people in my job, white men, who say there's no such thing as unequal pay between men and women. Like
what?
Like I have guys that'll be like, yo, that's a complete fallacy. When you look at the statistics, and they'll point out statistics and say, when you look at each job for what it is and experience, people are paid by their experience. And there's just not enough women that had the same experience as men.
Well, I want to pause there because that's a whole other topic
for another day. And people
speak out of the ignorance of what they don't know, and you just have to excuse them for their ignorance and teach them other ways of learning the reality.
I've gotten to a point where I'm not even addressing ignorance, because you can't make somebody that's ignorant be woke or not knowledgeable.
You can't.
Like, so you just got it, like, and that's been frustrating me so much. So I just
watch Pontius Pilate. Since it's
Good Friday, I do like Pontius Pilate. I wash my hands in the water. I was like, that's on y'all. If y'all gonna be a dumbass, that's your own fault for being a dumbass. And I walk away because I can't keep having arguments with folks. Like, if I'm trying to tell somebody, like, there's a such thing as white privilege, and you going to argue with me, like, I work just as hard. That's not what white privilege is about. But you just refuse to understand
And see, we've talked about that. I don't want to go too far off because we do have... Eric, when you talk black power with T, T goes all the way black. He goes all the way to starting revolutions. He doesn't. The revolution will not be televised when you're talking to T about the black man's struggle.
That's right. Okay, keep it real, man. I want to bring it back, and I do want to let everybody know
that get your book, Amazon, iBooks, Kindle, get the book, Finding
Gideon. And also, they can go by my website, www.ericjeromedickey.com, and there should be some places to click on to buy, and also the tour schedule is posted.
Yes, it is. And even if you miss the book, you miss the part of the series, you miss something, like, you can order all of his books and buy them right there. So I think you should just go to the website and just click it. I mean, everything. iBooks, Google Play, Walmart, Target. I mean, Books a Million, Bars. And I mean, it's there. Just click it. Buy it. Make it happen.
Thanks. I really appreciate it.
Such a pleasure, and I am excited for the character. I'm just ready to see his next adventure, because we're still, you know, he's still got some trouble to get into. I feel like Gideon gonna get in more trouble in. Yes, and you know, I'm going to speak Gideon into onto the big screen. I think that will be a great big screen. We can have 20 Fast and the Furious movies. I think we could have a couple Gideon movies, I'm just saying. We could
At least three of them.
Man.
We speak it into existence.
That's right.
Just power in the tongue.
Absolutely. Eric, I just want to thank you for hanging out, and it was such a pleasure talking to you and dropping your wisdom and your experience, and I'm just, your career is just so astronomical, and it's such a blessing, you know, to have readers follow you from, you know, 10, 20, 15, even new readers. Like, you're just continuously growing. And it's just, it's an awesome, awesome, awesome blessing. And I'm just so happy.
Thank you. Thanks for the support. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Well, it's definitely been a pleasure.
And yes. It's Good Friday, man. We're making things happen.
I'm going to go see Get Out again now.
Stay woke. Don't go into the sunken place. Don't fall into
it. You know what I mean?
No teacups.
Oh, yeah. I'm getting nervous every time I go into a coffee shop now. I'm thinking, who got a teacup?
You know what I'm saying? Stay woke.
Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the Justmisslee Experience. Eric Jerome Dickey signing Gideon. April 17th, pick it up, get your copy. We'll be back, man. We're gonna play a little LaPortia Renee, Good Woman, because we talked about Good Woman and she has good hair and she just ain't taking no ish. And we're gonna go to that and we're gonna be back.
All right. You go.
Boy, I'm telling you, God is my witness. You gon' sit right here and listen till I'm finished. 'Cause you ain't got nowhere to go. Don't think I don't know that you ain't been telling the truth. Don't make me have to slap you about your feelings. Don't make me show you in your side, check the business. I'm tired, oh, of playing these games. You promise you change. Pay a couple bills, make a couple meals, make my body feel good half the time.
But I can't do that for myself.
I can't make you love me right, make you realize what's right in front of your eyes.
Cause I'm a real good
I'm a good, good, good woman. Ladies and gentlemen, it is time for tea time with Miss Lee, and tonight I am sipping on some old natural black tea with a little honey and lemon, and I'm going to stir my little cup, and I'm going to sip. And, you know, this is just going to be a quick little message to my ladies, and this is just some love from me to you. It's getting warm, ladies. It's getting warm. And there are some important things we ladies need to be sure that's right before we walk out the door in our warmness. So, ladies and gentlemen, it is the season of pedicures. Make sure we get our feet dig before we start showing our toes. Ladies and gentlemen, ladies, let's ensure that we have the right size sandals before we start walking outside and our toes are holding on for dear life with some cushion. And ladies and gentlemen, make sure our ladies, let's be sure that we are walking with some class. You know what I'm saying? Just because it's warm, we got our sundresses on. Let's not wear sundresses that go too short and the wind blowing, we see all of our glory. You know, let's keep it classy. Let's keep it fresh. Let's keep it beautiful as we sip our tea. That's tea time with Miss Lee. Gotta throw it back to my boy JT. What is it,
yeah.
JT?
Chilling.
Gotta have some girl time on that. You know what I'm saying? Ladies gotta have their toes done. It's getting warm. I'm sorry. It's not
I feel
sport.
You. I feel you. I'm here. I'm ready to go.
Go ahead with.
I don't know.
Yeah.
So a question was proposed to me from one of the listeners. They said, why don't I think we have a lot of minority owners in the NFL? Well, before T gets midnight on us again, there's a couple of reasons. Before you get midnight, there's a couple of reasons. Now, a lot of the teams have been around since the beginning of, you know, since football started back in the 20s. Like, I think the teams like the Giants, the Eagles, the Packers, mm-hmm. all still, a lot of them have their original owners. And if the original owner, they passed it down, it stayed in their family. Like the Giants. The Wellington Mara bought the Giants, then he passed it down to his sons, yada, yada, yada. The Steelers, the Rooney family, they've been there since the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But then you have certain situations. Back in 2011, the Jacksonville Jaguars went for sale.
Mm-hmm.
A Pakistani-American, Shahid Khan, happened to have $760 million laying around. It was able to buy the team outright.
Mm-hmm.
So there was no vote needed by the other owners. None of that. He had $760 million and bought the team.
Mm-hmm.
But there was, now that he tried to buy, before that, he tried to buy 60% of the Rams, which would have made him majority owner. But that fell through. That fell through. And then the Jacksonville Jaguars, you know, came for sale. So, if a black man could, you know, let's just say Jay-Z and P. Diddy put their efforts together, they could have bought the Jacksonville Jaguars if they wanted to, you know. But Khan, he's worth his net worth is like $7, $8 billion. So he can do that. You know, Jay-Z and them still ain't got that kind of money yet, but if they came together,
they don't got no billions.
They ain't got no billions, but if they came together, they could
not to
put
spare.
Something together to do it.
Not to spare.
No.
All,
and that's
all the eggs in one basket.
No. What they would have to do is they would have to come together. Let's just say Oprah and Dr. Dre. They probably the two richest. She's rich in what she does.
People
and he's cracking almost. Right. Oh, no, here you go. Let's just say Jordan and Oprah got together. They wanted to buy an NFL team. What they would have to do is, if there's no team for sale, they got to find the city. They got to get the city to agree to have the team. Then they got to go through the permits to try to get the city to pay for the team if they don't have $8 billion to build the stadium. They got to get the funding for the stadium. It's not easy. So let's just say they were able to get all of that done. Then this is a new expansion team that would have to be made. Then you got to get the rest of the NFL owners to vote on if it was if they want another expansion team. Doesn't matter who's trying to buy it, they got to vote on if they want an expansion team, period. Okay? So if they do want the expansion team, they got to vote on that. If they get the votes, then you got to get the money, you got to get the funding, yada, yada, yada. So you literally have to have billions or at least a few hundred million to spare in order to make that happen.
Yeah, because like, what was the last expansion team we had was Jacksonville and North Carolina?
No. Technically, the last expansion team we had were the Texans and the Cleveland Browns.
Yeah.
And remember, the Browns
because they left
the Ravens.
Baltimore.
Right. The Browns became the Ravens, but then they brought the Browns back. But technically, it was an expansion team. So technically,
if Oprah and Jordan got together and they sweet-talked Janet Jackson because now she got a quick $500 million for popping out that baby, they could go ahead and make something happen because she got an extra $500 million to spare.
Right. If they was able to – right. If those three –
Janet ain't buying no football team.
I mean,
hey, listen,
she had a great business deal. She got an extra $500 million for popping out a baby.
You never know. You never,
she don't need it. She don't need the money.
Me. That is insane to me.
She don't need the money. What Janet need the money for? She got enough. She could invest in a football team in Indiana.
But yeah.
Or in the Midwest, you know, Chicago, Illinois,
but
Indiana.
You know, but you'd have to pick the right city. You got to make sure it's a city that's going to generate money.
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense to build a team in Wichita, Kansas. Like, what the hell? You know what I'm saying? You're not
right.
So you got all of that. You know, makes revenue.
Yeah.
You know, like, why would I build a team in Montana? That just doesn't make sense. There's nobody living.
Yeah.
There. You know.
Hawaii needs a team. Gotta be freaking awesome.
Hawaii?
Nah.
You know, it's...
They generate money. A lot
possible.
Of tourist money.
It is possible.
It is. It is.
What?
Nah.
I wouldn't build my team in Hawaii. I wouldn't do that. Because what if they got to play the Eagles, that flight is insane.
Yeah.
That's
take away from your practice time.
And then they already trying to go international. They thinking about putting a team in London. They're trying to do it.
Right.
They're thinking about putting a team in Mexico. They're thinking about Canada, you know, and already – and just think about the California teams that got to fly to London. That's crazy. Now, let's just say you put a team in Hawaii. That's more hours from Hawaii to London.
But think about it. For an East Coast team to play a Hawaiian team, that would be a preseason situation. They wouldn't be in. They would have to see them mainly during playoffs. You know what I'm saying? That wouldn't be a big deal for someone that's already a team playing in California or in Arizona. That's not a bad flight for them. But it is a bad flight for.
I think
and
you
in
just
want
to go to Hawaii, Lee. You just want to go to Hawaii for a home game. That's all you want to do. Like, at the end of the day, that's all you want to do.
I mean,
I think we should just keep the Pro. We should keep the Pro Bowls to a Hawaii. But, like, you know, the whole question of black people being owners in the NFL. Really, we got to go through that whole power structure. Who's letting black people in to be owners? Like, we got to go
never,
through those power gates.
But to see,
we
got to
go through
thing.
Those gates
it's never been,
power.
It's never been tried before. It's never been tried, so we can't say
and
what
until,
will happen.
And until, like, 3037, when everybody looks at people as people, then it could happen. But until then, like, you got this old boy network. And as much as we like to think that you know, oh, racism is a thing of the past. F-O-H. Racism is a thing of today. And racism is only a thing of today because that's used as a means to divide people. People with power ain't trying to give up power, period. If you got power, if you did whatever you needed to do to get power, you not giving that up for nothing. Why you think it got to go through all of the owners to vote and say, yeah, we're okay with another team to come in for it to get in? Because they got power, and they ain't trying to give up no more power than they already got. That's all I'm saying.
He got black on you,
I mean,
JP.
Yeah, I know. I knew midnight was coming. Actually,
you know I was.
He went about 1:30 on that one. He went past midnight.
That's right. Like at the end of the day, like there's a pie. Right now there's a pie. Everybody has a slice of the pie. Ain't nobody trying to give up their slice of the pie. And then give up their slice of the pie for a black guy. Fuck out of here. That shit ain't happening.
Well,
but
it's
never been tried, though. It's never been tried. We gotta wait to see it get. We gotta wait
who
for it to
try?
Actually happen.
Who gonna try, JT?
I mean, think about it. Like
break
this.
The barrier.
But hold on.
Wow,
outside of Oprah, how many black billionaires do we know?
She don't give a fuck about football.
But that's not the point. The point is she could do it if she wanted to.
If she wanted to, if you got the money, you
that's
can make things happen.
If,
and that's
if,
about the power
Cosby,
of the dollar
bill. Bill Cosby, before he raped like 1,000 chicks, wanted to do
oh,
that.
Oh, Jesus, allegedly.
Maybe,
allegedly.
Allegedly. But, like,
in the spirit
Cosby,
of Bernie Mac,
that's the whole thing.
If you got the dollar bill, the dollar bill, in the spirit of Bernie Mac, and Players Club, you know, I'm dollar bill, and that's just what ruled the world. But what I'm saying, ladies and gentlemen, it's the Miss B Experience, T, JT, and of course myself. We will be back next week, and, you know, I don't know if these fellas are going to enjoy the topic because we're talking about ladies' curves and strength and our power and our empowerment with special guest Destiny Morales.
I enjoy the curve.
Because the fellas, we had the gentleman from Camp Ink Records. He was on the show a couple months back. Their first lady of their record label is joining us with her new song, and the name of her song is Scrumdiddlyumptious, and it's talking about the scrumdiddlyumptiousness of a woman and how sexy we are and how we have something that men crave. So she's going to be joining us. We'll be back next week. Have a happy Easter. Be blessed, and hug your neighbor, man. You know, get your power back. We're going to talk about this again. Much love.
Stay midnight.